today's edition of the CrossFit Games Update Show. I'm Sean Woodland with Tommy Marquez as we get set for week two of the team series. Four more events getting released, and we have added some elements here for these next four events that we certainly did not see in week number one.
Oh yeah, a ton to chew on. We have a repeat workout, a ton of grip work, and we continue to kind of up the ante with some team-specific skills in week number two that's really going to test some people. Things like synchronized movements, isolation holds, and partner lifts.
Yeah, four more events. Let's give you a quick rundown of what they are. We'll get into them specifically here in just a second, but here is the broad overview. Event five has those static holds with a deadlift bar and a ton of wall ball shots and handstand push-ups. Event six, that's just max muscle-ups. Event number seven, now we have pairs mixed gender pairs working in that one, clean and jerks, and then those synchronized movements, and then event eight is actually a repeat. So let's break these down individually. So event number five, this is going to be a pretty burly event. It is male, male, female, female pairs, two athletes working at the same time, and then two athletes doing a hold. We start with 200 wall ball shots, two athletes moving, two athletes holding a deadlift bar that weighs 340 pounds. It's unevenly weighted. And then 150 partner deadlifts. So that's the only movement where you don't have two partners holding a bar. And then 200 handstand push-ups, two athletes moving, two holding the deadlift bar. Now, every event that we have, you gotta have a plan going in, but you can figure some things out on the fly. Not this one. You really have to plan this out from beginning to the end very specifically.
Absolutely. There's so many moving parts in this workout and so many different ways to kind of slice this up. This is a workout where I would have every single rep and every single rotation planned out up through the wall balls and the deadlifts. Don't be afraid to break a little bit early, especially with some quick transitions, because you'll lose significantly more time if you burn out through the first two movements and then get to the handstand push-ups and people are just staring at the wall, shaking out their arms, burning precious time because they didn't pace the first two movements a little bit better. This, you could totally blow yourself up on this one.
Event number six, we go from complex to very simple. It's just 10 minutes of max muscle-ups with two athletes working. They do not have to be synchronized. There are two sets of rings, one for the men and one for the women, and they can't interchange between the rings. So when you first start this one, I think you're going to be tempted to go out and maybe blow out a big set, especially if you're good at this movement, but you're going to want to avoid that temptation and break this up into manageable pieces.
Yeah, and what's manageable is going to vary from person to person. Some of the top athletes might be able to hold 7, 6, 5 reps for the entirety of the workout. Others maybe less than that. I'm going to go so far as to say if you have 5+ muscle-ups unbroken and you fail a muscle-up before the 9-minute mark, you have mispaced this workout and you have messed it up seriously. I would actually start with a very conservative strategy. 10 minutes is a long time for just one movement. Start with 25, maybe 30% of your max unbroken muscle-ups, and then work down from there. Use some descending reps, maybe like a pyramid scheme where you go down and come back up. That way you have short breaks, dedicated rest in between while the other partner works to make sure that you have plenty in the tank for the last few minutes.
Event number seven, this is where the synchronized movements come in. It's a mixed gender pair, male, female, one pair working at a time. It's a 20-minute AMRAP of 5 clean and jerks, 185 for the men, 135 for the women. Then the pair moves on and completes 10 synchronized toes to bar. You do that, then you tag off to the next pair. It's back and forth for 20 minutes. And the toes to bar really dictate how you're going to pair this one up, right?
Absolutely. And most teams will have maybe one, two very strong athletes at toes to bar. So I would take your two best athletes at toes to bar and split them. Put them in different pairs. That way, in each pair going, you have an athlete that can adjust his or her tempo to match up with the other athlete to make sure you're not piling up costly no reps in this workout. You're essentially getting a one-to-one rest throughout this workout as each pair alternates. So having too many reps is going to cost you because other teams that have the synchronized aspect down are going to be able to push the throttle.
And finally, event number eight, we have a repeat. First time in the team series that we have a repeat, of course, the second year we've done it, but this is one of the events that we did last year, and it is the 12 minutes for the men and then 12 minutes for the women. So the two men go out, and one completes 30 double-unders, 15 power snatches at 75 pounds, tags his partner. They repeat that for 12 minutes. Once the 12-minute mark hits, then the women go through. They will do 15 power snatches at 65 pounds and then 30 double-unders preceding that. This one, pretty simple. I mean, you just have to go, but there are some small things here that you can keep in mind to make sure that you get as good a score as possible.
Yeah, absolutely. Regardless of your fitness level, this is a workout where you're going to be able to push the pedal for the majority of your pair's 12-minute mark. Especially early on, you want to focus on some smooth, unbroken double-unders to kind of save the shoulders. And then regardless of how strong you are, you can shoot for big sets on the power snatch because it is so light. But early on, what your power snatch looks like might vary a little bit. For the early rounds, a more upright torso, maybe posit the hip on the way down to kind of save your lower back for the last few minutes of the workout, to where once you get to those later rounds, your hips might end up a little bit higher on the way down, you might not posit the hip, and you're just gripping and ripping, trying to make up some time before the time cap hits.
Let's talk overall strategy and how you break these up. So you have four events that you have to get done in a matter of days, and let's assume that everybody has a perfect schedule. And ideal world, you can do these, you'll have plenty of time to get these done. How would you break these up over a period of time?
Well, in this week in particular, I'm not gonna do more than one workout a day, but we're gonna start on Wednesday with event number 6 in the muscle-ups. For a lot of people, muscle-ups is gonna be a limiting factor. They're not gonna be their strongest movements. You wanna get those out of the way when your grip, when your pull strength, when you're pressing out of the dip is at its strongest. So then come back Thursday, you're gonna do event number 7, the clean and jerk and the toes to bar. Now there's a significant midline tax with these synchronized toes to bar, but you know what, you have a 1-to-1 rest, so you can get that out of the way knowing you're gonna have a rest day on Friday. During your rest day, be productive, go into the gym, practice some muscle ups, take what you learned from Wednesday's event and maybe apply some skill movements there. Saturday, we're gonna tackle event number 5, the wall ball deadlift and handstand pushup. This workout is what I call the central nervous system scrambler, with heavy deads, heavy holds, getting upside down, tons of wall balls. You wanna hit this one right off of a rest day when you're fresh and you don't have to worry about maybe a heavy load coming on Sunday, because Sunday you're gonna do event number 8, which is that light power snatch and double under one. That one is just really gas tank, and the interference from the other workouts isn't gonna be too high on this workout, so you can do it towards the end of your programming. Monday, come back, retest event number 6 with the muscle ups.
And if you're going scaled, the muscle up event is chest bar pull ups. That kind of changes how maybe you want to order these, right?
Yeah, I would actually try and move that one back a little bit. So for a lot of the scaled athletes, something like tons of chest to bar pull ups adds a high propensity for maybe hand tears or, you know, messing up your hands considerably for the rest of the week. So instead of doing that first, I might consider moving it back towards the weekend, because the last thing you want to do as a team is kick off week number 2 with you guys getting overzealous on the pull up bar. Yep. And then everyone tearing their hands, and then everyone having messed up hands for the rest of the week.
Be sure to go to the game site and check out the full event description for all these, so you know exactly what you're getting into, so you don't have to redo something because you didn't follow a rule or you didn't meet a movement standard. Submission deadline for all your scores Monday at 5 p.m. Pacific time. If you're going to show your events on Facebook Live, be sure you include the hashtag Team Series Live so we can find it, possibly share it with the CrossFit Games audience as well. Definitely want to check you guys out when you're doing that. And then next week is it's the end of the Team Series, but it's also the liftoff registration date. That's Thursday, October 13th. So still one more event to go for the community before we close out 2016. And then the 2017 Open will quickly be upon us. Have fun with the Team Series events. Make sure you share it on social media. We love seeing that stuff. For Tommy Marquez, I'm Sean Woodland. We'll see you next time.